So the fourth seal, as I've been talking about, the seals of Revelation, you can look at them as seven campaigns, and that reveal something about the aspect of God's character, particularly Jesus, because after all, the name of the book is the revelation of Jesus. The book is not about some beast and some scary stuff, but it's about a revelation of Jesus Christ. In other words, once you get to know someone, it's very important. Like, we want to get to know Jesus because we believe that we're saved by grace through faith, by having a relationship with Christ. Then to know the book of Revelation, which is a revelation of Jesus, becomes vital. Because how can we have a relationship with someone but not know his plans and not know what he's trying to tell us? So a revelation of Jesus is very important, especially to those living at the time of the end. So let's go to Revelation 8, Revelation 8, 1. Actually, 8:2. We began talking about this a little bit last week, so we'll just recap briefly. In Revelation 8:2, the Bible says, "And I saw the seven angels who stand before God, and to them were given seven trumpets." So the seven special angels that do a special work for God. These angels are called, like, they're as bright as a torch, because that's the nature of these angels. They're powerful angels that do a work for God. They serve God before his throne. And so they're given seven trumpets. All right. So, but the Bible doesn't tell us when. And we're not going to get into that today. But now, turn your Bible to Revelation 7. Revelation 7, are you guys there? Starting at verse 1. So here we have, it says, "After this I saw four angels standing in the four corners of the earth, holding back the four winds of the earth to prevent any wind from blowing on the land and on the sea and on any tree. Then another angel coming from the east, having the seal of the living God, he called out in a loud voice to the four angels who had been given power to harm the land and the sea, 'Do not harm the land or the sea or the trees until we have put a seal on the servants on the foreheads of the servants of our God.' Then I heard the number of those who were sealed, 144,000 for all the tribes of Israel." So what we have here is we have four angels. I believe four of the eight, of the seven, they got in place and they're ready to cause. Notice what verse 3 says, that the end of verse 2 says that they had been given power to harm the land and the sea. But then right before they were about to blow their trumpets and to do the work that they had been given power to do, a fifth one, he came from the east having the seal of the living God. And he said to the four angels, "Hey, do not do that. Do not do what you have been given power to do. Do not do it yet. Because first we need to seal the servants of our God, the 144,000. Then, after that, you go ahead and do what you've been given power to do."
I have a question.
Yes.
This is four angels. He received that wind. He don't know if he need to, this angel, five angels coming to tell him, "You need to wait to put his seal." They don't know that yet.
They didn't know at that time, yes. In other words, they have been given power to do the work that God told them to do. So they went ahead and very obediently was carrying out the work. But before they were able to accomplish the work that God gave them to do, another angel was dispatched. And this angel says, "Wait, do not do it."
Just these four, you don't understand.
Exactly. Okay. And if you remember, so there is a delay, right? They're told to wait, and then they could do the devastation. But it's very interesting because Jesus says in Matthew 25 that because the bridegroom delayed or tarried, the virgins fell asleep. So obviously Jesus is making reference that there is a delay right before his coming. Now, traditionally the church have not really understood what these four angels are. Some speculate that this is historic, some speculate that this is future. There is not a common ground or agreement. Okay? But obviously you know that is not historically, because the 144,000 have not been sealed yet. So that's very easy to detect. Now, in order for us to understand this, and you're like, wait a second, I thought the fourth seal was in Revelation 6. Yes, it is. But this is, I'm setting the grounds here for us to actually identify what the fourth seal is. And the fourth and the connection between the fourth seal and what we just read. In order for us to do that, we're going to have to do a little bit of digging, a little bit of work. And I'm going to take you guys into the Old Testament. And I hope you feel like studying your Bible today, because this is going to be a good one. We're going to have to read a lot of scripture, because I believe that if I just tell you guys, it doesn't do anything. The word is what convicts. You see what I'm saying? I can tell you like a concept, and you'll be like, yeah, that's a great concept, but that's it. But the word of God, when we read it, there's something about the word of God. There's life in it, and that's what convicts. That's what changes. And that's why I usually never talk concept. You know, I usually like to go into the word. Turn to Leviticus 25. And I promise I'm going to try to keep this as simple as possible and as succinct as possible. But I could get into so many details that are fascinating, but I'm going to try to prevent myself from doing it. So we're going to be looking at verse 1. But let me say this. When God delivered the children of Israel from Egypt, 15 days before the deliverance, God appeared to Moses, and God told them, tell the people that this day will be their new year. So God actually changed their calendar from an Egyptian calendar that functioned around the sun from summer to summer into a spring to spring calendar, which is God's calendar, Jubilee calendar. And we can read this in Leviticus 12, 1 and 2, and other places as well. But so God gave the Israelites a whole bunch of directions that God wanted them to do when they left Egypt. Particularly, a lot of people believe that God only gave them these directions by the time they entered the promised land, but that's not the case. God gave them directions even before, but what happens is that, you remember, for 40 years they wandered in the wilderness. So they didn't have to plant anything to eat because they were wandering. They were not in one place. But as soon as they entered the promised land, then God addressed the issue again, and God makes it very fresh to them what his will is concerning what God wants them to do. Leviticus 25, starting at verse 2, the Bible says, let's go to verse 1. The Lord said to Moses on Mount Sinai, speak to the Israelite and say to them, when you enter the land that I'm going to give you, the land itself must observe a Sabbath to the Lord. For 6 years, sow your fields, and for 6 years, prune your vineyard and gather their crops. But on the seventh year, the land is to have a Sabbath rest, a Sabbath to the Lord. Do not sow your fields or prune your vineyards. Do not reap what grows of itself or harvest the grapes of your untended vines. The land is to have a year of rest. Whatever the land yields during the Sabbath year will be for food for you, for yourself, for your manservant, for your maidservant, and the hired worker, and the temporary resident who lived among you, as well as for your livestock and for the wild animals in your land. Whatever the land produces, you may eat. So God said to them, plant the land, cultivate the land freely for 6 years, and on the seventh year, do not harvest, do not plant, don't even touch what grows by itself. And this is to be a Sabbath of the land. So God wanted them to rest that land for 1 year, every seventh year. Now, it's very interesting that when you look at the creation, and I don't want to spend a whole lot of time in this, but God started the day by giving, for example, we know where the month came from, we know where the year came from, but no one can tell you where the week came from. And whether you believe in God or not, you still have to abide that he came from Genesis. God says, Sister Cheryl, question? No. God, you know, I usually joke with people, I said, a week is 7 days, but 7 days is not a week. Because a week begins on the day one. God says the first day of the week, then the second day of the week, third, fourth, fifth, until all the way until the seventh. Then the week begins again. It's continuous, you know, there is no end to this cycle. So, but I may say, well, I'm going away for a week, but I'm leaving on Wednesday, and I'm coming back next Wednesday. That's not a week. That's 7 days, but that's not a week. Because a week begins on the first day and ends on the seventh. All right? So God expanded, and he said to the people, all right, so you cultivate for 6 years, and then you rest the seventh year, which is the Sabbath of the land. And then notice what God does. God builds upon this template, and then he actually, there's other things that he actually enlarged, like the Pentecost and some other stuff that I'm not going to get into it right now. But he keeps enlarging this template. He used the week as a template, as a microcosm of something a lot bigger. Now notice what happens in Leviticus 25, starting at verse 8 through 11. Notice what God tells them. So God says to them, count off 7 Sabbaths of years, 7 times 7 years, so that the 7 Sabbaths of years amount to a period of 49 years. Now let me make an observation here. God says to them, count off 7 weeks of seven, which is, in other words, 1 week of year, 7 years, 7 times. You know, 1 week, it's 7 days. Now he's talking about a week of years, which is 7 years, 7 times, which is 49 years. Now notice that God says, count off 7 Sabbaths. He never told them when to begin counting. He expected them to know when to begin counting. Because God wants them to begin counting from the time of the Exodus. Because that's when God told them to, that's when God changed their calendar from summer to summer to spring. And that from that time, they began keeping track of time, and God gave them this very specific directions on keeping track of time. So there was no way for them not to know. See what I'm saying? So yeah, this is very fascinating. And God never told them to stop counting. That's why, so now I'll expand this in a little bit. But notice what verse 9 says. Then have the trumpet sounded everywhere on the 10th day of the 7th month, on the Day of Atonement. Sound the trumpet throughout your land. I'm reading from Leviticus 25, start at verse 10. Consecrate the 50th year and proclaim liberty throughout the land to its inhabitants. It shall be a jubilee for you. Each of you is to return to his own family property, and each of to his own clan. The 50th year shall be a jubilee for you. Do not sow, do not reap what grows of itself, or harvest the untended vines. So another, once again, God used the week, and he expanded it to now 7 weeks of seven, which is 49. And then he said to them, and on the 50th year, at the end of the 49, the 50th year is going to be a whole year of rest for you and the land. So don't plant, don't, just the same way. Let the land rest. So what we just read is God says rest the land every seventh year and count the jubilees and rest every 50th year. Those are Sabbath, those years, the whole year, those years are to be holy for you. Do not touch the land. Do not plant. Just rest on me that I'm the provider for you. And I would encourage you guys to read these chapters, the whole chapter 25 and 26 at home. It's fascinating because God actually told them, says, look, I want you, if you guys do what I'm telling you, and we're going to read a little bit of it later, you're going to be so blessed. I'm going to take care of you. You're going to be my special people. No one is going to be able to touch you, offend you. And by the time you plant your first year, you're going to have to make room from your storehouse to remove some of the old food to be eaten first and put the new one in the back of the storehouse. And God is promising them to take care of them if they abide by these promises. So it's very interesting. So now, let me make a point here. Then later on, as you know, the 70 weeks of Daniel, God once again says, expands the Jubilees in tens. 490 years or 490 days is simply 7 times 7, 10 times. It's 10 cycles of Jubilees. 449, 10 times. And then God's, you know, when he begins the prophecy, do you remember how he gives the prophecy of the 70 weeks? He doesn't say just, oh, it's 490 years. No, he begins by saying there will be 62 weeks plus 7 times 7 plus 1, remember? So 7 times 7 is 49. He is letting the hearer know that he is counting that prophecies in Jubilees. And just like every prophecy begins, just like a week begins on Sunday, each week of 7 years begin on Sunday year. For example, first year, that's a Sunday year. Second year is a Monday year. Tuesday year, you understand, all the way into the seventh year, then you rest. Same thing with the week of Jubilees.
No, I don't understand.
Okay, well, for example, God says, you know, the first day of the week is Sunday, right? So the week of 7 years, then you have Sunday year, then you have Monday year, Tuesday year, Wednesday year, Thursday year, Friday year, then seventh, you know, the Sabbath year, and then you rest the land, just like the week. And so even those weeks that he expanded from the creation week, it always had to begin on a Sunday year.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So the Jubilee also are always begin on a Sunday year. So what is fascinating, you see what I'm saying? So it's very important because once you understand something of the Jubilee calendar, not only you're able to, if you know one Jubilee and when to start counting, you can actually, it's just like the days of the week. If you know what Thursday is today, you can actually find out the date for Wednesday, for Monday, for Tuesday. You see what I'm saying? Because you just count back and forth. So the Jubilee, it takes away all the scholarship from the Old Testament that we have to do. And to the best accuracy that scholars do, they steal off 10 years from the days of, from the day of the Exodus, because a lot of people don't understand anything about the Jubilee. But when you correct it with the Jubilee, then it's very simple to actually count back and forth. But one of these days, we're going to do a study on that. I just touched upon it today. Oh, it's over there. Yeah, he's going to go get me something to wipe it.
I have a question about verse 9.
Yes.
It says, then you shall cast the trumpet of the Jubilee to sound on the 10th day of the 7th month. We all know that Day of Atonement is once a year.
Yes.
So actually, two trumpets are sounding,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So Day of Atonement is not on the 10th day of the 7th month.
Yes.
It is?
Yes, it is.
Oh,
mm-hmm.
There's only one trumpet sounding.
Yes. Which would be around the Halloween time here,
right,
October
yes.
31st.
Yes.
Yes, right. Thank you so much. So the point that I'm making here that I want you to this is not part of the study, but I could not resist it to tell you, because, you know, these things takes repetition. But what I'm trying to say here is that when, you know, there are three or four decrees of the, to begin rebuilding Jerusalem, if you know about the 70 weeks, right? And we know that there is only one that is the right one. But interestingly, the one, you know, because the 490 years is a prophecy, and a prophecy has to begin on the first day one, which is a Sunday year, guess what? The only decree that begins on a Sunday year is AD 57. All the other years would not fit. So because of the Jubilee calendar, we're able to know exactly which decree it is, not just by, oh, thank you so much, not just by, because this is the one that fits us better, but it actually corrects us. And then you can actually count back, and you know that the Exodus happened in 1437 and not 1447 as believed by scholars. Because if you know something of the Jubilee, of the Jubilee calendar. So it's just fascinating. But we're going to have a whole study on that one of these days. Hey, God bless you, man. He has to go to a meeting. You want to have a question?
So according to that, when was the last Jubilee according to his rules?
According to whose
rules? Rules? The way he did the calendar. When was the last Jubilee?
Right now?
Yeah, in this century.
Okay, I believe the Jubilee calendar came to an end in 1994.
Oh, okay.
Which I
just read that.
Yes.
And I went to this chapter, Leviticus 25.
Yes.
I read this.
Yes.
But this did not appear to me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I that was beyond me.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, we're going to have a study on that. I'm going to cover in details. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to show you how amazing, how from when you look at 457 BC, which the decree to rebuild and restore Jerusalem went forth, you know, we usually understand that decree all the way up to AD 34 to be the end of the probation for the Jews. But what is fascinating is when you rewind from 457 another 490 years, it comes to 947 AD, which is exactly the year that Solomon dedicated the temple to God. And God, yes, no, AD. Oh, BC, I apologize. Yeah, BC. So 947 BC, which is exactly the year Solomon dedicated the temple to God. And the Bible actually tells us that how long it took for Solomon to begin building his temple and how long it took him to build it. So from there, from the time of the Exodus, the Bible actually tells us that it was 480 years from the time of the Exodus, and then that he began building the temple. So then we know how long it took. So when you do all the math, it brings you to exactly 1437 BC. So 1437 BC, all the first big day of 490 years went all the way up to 947. God dedicated the temple. Then the temple was in between that big day. The temple was destroyed. Then at the end of that one more big day, that was big day Monday, then there was a decree to rebuild the temple. Okay?
So the destruction of the temple, you're talking after Christ?
No, before that, Christ.
Oh, before.
We're talking about, yeah.
The Solomon. Destruction.
Yes, because they had, yeah, they destroyed it, and then God's people was told, you know, when Nebuchadnezzar came and had the siege, they took them all into captivity. Okay. But then there was another command for them to go ahead and rebuild it.
Again.
Yes.
After
so,
captivity.
Right. But I'm just touching upon it. It's very fascinating. But I don't even know why I'm going into that. It's just too tempting to pass by and not say something. Now,
it must be important because it's coming up.
Yes.
It's coming up.
Yes, it's very important for us to understand. And the Jubilee calendar is one of the most fascinating studies. It is very deep. It's very difficult to understand. But once you grasp it, it's just so fascinating because you're able to determine the year of Christ's death and his baptism year.
When was it? AD
30.
Not 31.
Not 31, yes. And it's fascinating. But this can be proven in many different ways, and we'll talk about that in the future. Uh-huh. So now let's go to Leviticus 26, and I want to show you something. Starting at verse 3 all the way to 35. And now I'm going to stick with the study here to try to make this big point to show you something pretty amazing that I find amazing. Remember, the fourth seal is the revelation of Christ's authority. The revelation of Christ. I usually say that God made man in our image, but we have made him in our image nowadays. So Leviticus 26, starting at verse 3, and we're going to read it all the way through 35. Notice what a lot of people fail to understand, and especially evangelical Christians in America, regarding the end times, eschatology, and how things are going to take place. Everyone's eyes is in Jerusalem nowadays. All the Christian world, our brothers and sisters that are Sunday keepers, they're usually looking for Jerusalem for the end times events. And this is because they don't understand the difference of unilateral and bilateral prophecies. A unilateral prophecy or a conditional, unconditional prophecy is a prophecy that I can say to you, for example, I am going to bring you some food tomorrow. I mean, that's unconditional. That's unilateral. I'm going to bring it, and you don't have to do a thing about it. It's going to come to pass, if I say so.
Unless you have a car accident.
Unless I have a car accident. That's right. But if everything goes well, if everything goes well, it will. But if God says it, you know, then it will happen. Mm-hmm. Now, a bilateral or conditional is that if I say to you, I will cook for you if you come to my house. You see, there's two ends of the deal there.
So I'll destroy Nineveh?
Absolutely. Hello. Yes, welcome. Yes, so yeah, that's a very good point. Yeah, that's a bilateral, yes. So when God's dealing with the Jews, a lot of people think that their prophecies were unilateral, but they were actually bilateral. And notice, we're going to see this here. God says in Leviticus 26, verse 3, if you follow my decrees and are carefully to obey my commandments. You see that? There's condition involved, if. And then it says, then I will send you rain in its season, and the ground will yield its crops, and the trees of the field their fruit. The threshing will continue until grape harvest, and the grape harvest will continue until planting. And you will eat all the food you want and live in safety in your land. I will grant peace in the land, and you will lie down, and no one will make you afraid. I will remove savage beasts from the land, and the sword will not pass through your country. I would like you to please underline the word wild beasts and sword in your Bibles. In verse 6. And then God says, you will pursue your enemies, and they will fall by the sword before you. 5 of you will chase 100, and 100 of you will chase 10,000, and your enemies will fall by the sword before you. I will look on you with favor and make you fruitful and increase your numbers. I will keep my covenant with you. You will be still eating last year's harvest when you have to remove it out to make room for the new. Remember what I said earlier? I will, now notice this amazing verse. I will put my dwelling place among you. I will not abhor you. I will walk among you and be your God. This is Jesus telling them, I will walk among you and be your God, and you will be my people. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt so that you would no longer be slaves to the Egyptians. I broke the bars of your yoke and enable you to walk with your head held high. So God is saying, if you listen to me and do everything I say, you're going to be my special child. I'm going to take care of you. I'm going to protect you. You're going to be blessed. And God said something amazing here. I will put my dwelling place among you. This is called the Day of the Lord prophecies, which a lot of times we misunderstand that with the second coming of Christ in the end. But Day of the Lord prophecies have nothing to do with the second coming prophecies. In fact, 99% of the references of what we usually think is the second coming references in the Old Testament is actually talking about the Day of the Lord. In other words, the kingdom of God coming to earth, And that's in fact what John the Baptist was preaching. And the Jews were believing that Christ was going to set up their kingdom on earth. Had the Jews been faithful, this was going to happen. That's why I believe Jesus allowed John the Baptist to actually die when he was in prison, because he believed in the kingdom that Christ was going to, he was preaching that Christ would set up his kingdom, but then he did not understand that God had already scratched plan A and God was already working under plan B because they were not faithful. Now look what the Bible says in verse 14. So after all these promises, God says, but if you will not listen to me and carry out what? All these commands. And if you reject my decrees and abhor my laws and fail to carry out all my commands and so violate the covenant. You see how it's a covenant, it's a dual. It's a bilateral. Then I will do this to you. I will bring upon you sudden terror, wasting disease and fever that will destroy your sight and drain away your life. You will plant seed in vain because your enemies will eat it. I will set my face against you so that you will be defeated by your enemies. Those who hate you will rule over you, and you will flee even when no one is pursuing you. And after all this, you will not listen. If after all this you will not listen to me, I will punish you for your sins seven times over. I will break down your stubborn pride and make the sky above you like iron and the ground beneath you like bronze. In other words, there will be no crops. If there is no rain, there is no crops. And it says, your strength will be spent in vain because your soils will not yield its crops, nor will the trees of the land yield their fruits. Now, let me ask you guys a question. If there is no crops, what is the cause? What happens to the people eventually? Famine. So keep that in mind. Famine. God says in verse 21, if you remain hostile towards me and refuse to listen to me, I will multiply your affliction seven times over as your sins deserve. Notice that he's only punishing them according to as their sins deserve. In other words, their sins have piled up, and now he will punish them for the amount of years they sinned. And it says, I will send you wild animals against you. Please underline that word. And they will rob you of your children, destroy your cattle, and make you so few in number that your roads will be deserted. And in spite of all these things, you do not accept my correction, but continue to be hostile towards me, I myself will be hostile towards you and will afflict you for your sins seven times over. I will bring the sword upon you, please underline that word, the sword, to avenge the breaking of the covenant. See, there is a covenant and that it could be broken. So once Israel broke their covenant, God went to plan B. So that's why all the prophecies that we read in Ezekiel 38, 39, that the whole Christian world is looking for to be the signs of the end, those prophecies will be forfeited. They will never come to be fulfilled because God is already under plan B. Okay, so that's why sometimes it could be so confusing. Now, the Bible says in verse 25, and I will bring the sword upon you to avenge the breaking of the covenant. When you withdraw your cities, I will bring a plague, please underline that word, among you, and you will be given into your enemies' hands. When I cut off your food supply and bread, 10 women will be able to bake your bread in one oven, and they will dole out the bread by weight. You will eat, but you will not be satisfied because it will be so little. But in spite of all this, if you still do not listen to me, but continue to be hostile towards me, then in my anger, I will be hostile towards you. I myself will punish you for your sins seven times over. You will eat the flesh of your sons and the flesh of your daughters. This is what they do when it's so, people have done that when they're starving. Like that one incident in the Andes, where people had to eat people because of starvation. I will destroy your high places and cut down your incense altars and pile your dead bodies on the lifeless forms of your idols. I will abhor you. I will turn your cities into ruins and lay waste your sanctuaries. I will take no delight in the pleasing aroma of your offerings. I will lay waste your land, the land. Now, let me stop here for a second. The reason why I'm covering all these things into details and going over these verses, you will see why this will be the, this will all add up, I promise you. Then something, a big picture is going to emerge. Verse 32, God says, I will lay waste the land, in other words, the land that they're living, so that your enemies who live there will be appalled. I will scatter you among the nations, and I will draw out my sword and pursue you. Your land will be laid waste, and your cities will lie in ruins. Now watch this, verse 34. Then the land will enjoy the Sabbath years all the time. You know, the seventh year, the land will rest, and on the 50th year, the land will rest. Then the land will enjoy its Sabbath years all the time that it lies desolate, and you are in the country of your enemies. Then the land will rest and enjoy its Sabbaths all the time that it lies desolate. The land will have the rest it did not have during the Sabbaths you lived in it. So what God is saying is this. If you guys want to be obedient to me, you're going to be my special people. Your life will be a blessing. I myself will live with you and be among you. But if you don't, then things are going to be tough. And I'm going to take the land from you, give it into your enemy's hands, and I'm going to remove you from the land. Then the land will finally rest the Sabbath years while that you did not allow it to, if you don't allow the land to have those Sabbath years of rest. In other words, if you don't give the land the rest that I'm telling you, I'm still going to make it rest one way or another. All right? So,
is that when Daniel and those went into captivity?
Absolutely. Yes. And you're going to see, you know, this is a very good question. A point that you're bringing up, because most people know that it was 70 years that they went into captivity, but very few people know why, and I'm going to show you why. Okay? Now, let's go to Jeremiah 25, verses 7 through 14. Jeremiah is right between Genesis and Revelation. All right, I had to say that because we're recording. I know. It's not funny. All right, Jeremiah 25, starting at verse 7 through 14. Then I'm going to show you a very interesting principle here. Let's start at verse 7. This is pretty much the same thing here that God is saying. We're going straight into the part where but you did not listen to me. So verse 7, the Bible says in Jeremiah 25, but you did not listen to me, declares the Lord, and you have provoked me with what your hands have made, and you have brought harms to yourselves. Therefore, the Lord Almighty says this, because you have not listened to my words, I will summon all the peoples of the north and my servant Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, declares the Lord. I will bring them against this land and its inhabitants and against all the surrounding nations. Now, let me make two points here. God is saying, first here, he calls Nebuchadnezzar a pagan king, his servant. Remember in the light of the study that we have 3 weeks ago, how God has people that is not from this fold, even among non-Christians? Here's a biblical proof of it. I mean, we looked up so many other verses, but this is just one more. Now notice, so God is saying, look, if you don't do these things, then I'm going to bring Nebuchadnezzar against you and against this land. And notice in verse 10, I will banish from them the sounds of joy and gladness, the voices of the bride and the bridegroom, the sounds of the millstone, and the light of the lamp. This whole country will become a desolate wasteland, and these nations will serve the kings of Babylon 70 years. Now here's the principle. In times of apostasy, God brings a destroyer. In times of apostasy, God brings a destroyer. In other words, when the mercy of God, and I'm going to say this very slowly so you could write it, when the mercy of God loses its power to redeem, it's all over. In other words, when the grace of God has no more redeeming effect upon the people, it's all over. Remember what God said in Genesis 6? My flesh, and Psalms 103, my flesh shall not always strive with sin. In other words, God's Holy Spirit is always trying to influence us to surrender. And a people here. Now here, don't apply any of the stuff that we're studying to individual, to your own salvation. We're not talking about individuals. We're talking about corporation, a corporate body. Okay, we're talking about a nation. We're talking about a group of people. We're not talking about individuals. So please don't make that mistake and say, God is going to do this to me and I'm toasted. No. We're talking about a corporately speaking here. So in times of apostasy, when a whole nation becomes apostate and they actually legislate laws against the word of God, that's when the full cup of principle, which is a Bible study that we have to talk about here one of these days, but essentially is this, every nation or every group or people has a cup. And once that cup reaches fullness, then you can read about this in Genesis 15, 400 years before the Canaanites or the Amorites and the Canaanites were still living in Canaan, God told Abraham, says, in about four generations, I'm going to give this land to your, you know, to my descendants, to the Jews. And then you'd be like, wait a second, this is crazy. So God is just going to take from one and give it to another? That's not fair. No, but the Bible says, because their sins have not yet reached its fullness. You see what I'm saying? I think that's in Genesis 15, verses 14 and on. So in other words, by the end of the fourth generation, the Amorites had finally reached their cup was full. Then God simply brought destruction upon them and took the land from them. In other words, in times of apostasy, God brings a destroyer. And I'm going to show you this principle a little more clearly. And let me just say this for a second. A lot of people have a hard time assimilating the God of the Old Testament with the God of the New and how they can be one. I mean, I had to preach this from the church because people there will be like, wait a second, there's a very good God in the Old Testament, a mean God in the Old Testament, a very mellow one in the New. What is this? Is it two gods, two minds? No, it's exactly the same God. The problem is that we don't understand. We have actually, like I said, God has made us in his image, and we have now created Jesus in our image. So a lot of us worship an icon called Jesus, an idol that we have created. That is exactly how we want it, and do exactly whatever we want him to do, and like the things we like, and he's okay with everything. But when we study the word, it's not very much the same, but will you come? That's why I said the fourth seal reveals the authority of Christ. Now, notice in Jeremiah 25, continue to read in verse 12. The Bible says this, because remember, he says, if you, the Jews, actually, I was going to make another point. I'm sorry. The point that I was going to make is that people don't understand why a loving God would actually kill millions of people in the flood. All right? Well, that's the same principle. The cup is full, so God had to bring destruction. And the reason why he does, you're going to understand that in a little bit when I show you some other passages. It's going to become very clear to you, this principle. But the principle is this, is love. For example, if God had allowed the people, the antediluvians, to continue to live on in their wickedness, you know what would have happened? The chances are that you and I would have been wicked by their influence and would not be here today.
We would have been affected by their
Right. Absolutely. If wickedness is not controlled, you know, sin is a leprosy. It spreads and proliferates. So God has to intervene at points, and God has done this in several times throughout history. You know, for example, like, you know, Jericho and all the, you know, several places in the Bible, you know, even Jesus himself drank from this cup, remember? Lord, I prayed that, no, pass this cup from me, but not according to my will, but your will. That was the cup of sin of the world that Jesus had to endure and drink it. Babylon, when he's being punished, remember the full cup into the wrath of God, which is poured out full strength into the cup of his indignation, because the cup is full. So this principle is throughout the whole Bible. So, for example, let's just say, for example, that I go to the doctor, and the doctor says I have a flesh-eating bacteria in my foot. And it's already, like, my toes are gone already. And the doctor says, look, this is the worst kind. We have two choices. We either amputate your foot so it doesn't spread, or you'll be dead in 3 days. What do you think will be my immediate response? But I love my foot so much. I mean, it would be a very difficult thing to do, right? Yes, but no. I love it so much, but I love my life a lot more than I love my foot. So I would have to amputate my foot for the sake of the whole body. So God, out of love, had to amputate the antediluvians in order for the whole body could blossom and be here today. All right? So the reason is always love. Same thing in the wilderness. God opened the ground, and I believe it was 15 or 16,000 got eaten up in a big thing. Well, those people would be like poison. Their influence was poisonous. So God had to destroy and intervene in order for more lives would be spared. You see what I'm saying? Yes.
So he actually sent a destroyer, or did he allow destruction?
No. God simply opened the ground in the ground in the desert, and the people just fell into the hole. Okay. Yes. But this will become much clearer in a little bit. Now, notice at verse 12 now in Jeremiah 25. But when the 70 years are fulfilled, in other words, if the Jews don't obey what I'm saying, then I'm going to send a destroyer. They're going to captivity for 70 years. Then the land will rest. All right. Now, then when the 70 years are fulfilled, I will punish the king of Babylon and his nation, the land of the Babylonians, for their guilt, declares the Lord, and I will make it desolate forever. I will bring upon this land all the things I have spoken against it, that are written in the book of, and prophesied by Jeremiah against all the nations. So God is saying here that one, I'm going to use Nebuchadnezzar to punish the Jews because of their sin finally reached its fullness. And once I'm done with him, then by that time Nebuchadnezzar's cup is going to be full also. Then I'm going to punish him again by sending another destroyer. Now, we know historically that was the Medes and the Persia. But I can actually show you that in the Bible. Turn briefly to Jeremiah 51. Jeremiah 51. Jeremiah 51, the Bible says in verse 1, this is what the Lord says, see, I will stir up the spirit of a destroyer against Babylon and the people of Lab Kamai. Notice verse 11 and 12 of that same chapter. Jeremiah 51, verses 11 and 12. The Bible says, sharpen the arrows, take up the shields. The Lord had stirred up the kings of the Medes. Notice, because his purpose is to destroy Babylon, or Nebuchadnezzar, the Lord will take vengeance for his temple. Do you remember how they went into, and they used the sacred cup? Right, so God is actually you, because that finally reached their full cup, so God sent the Medes and the Persians to punish them. That's exactly what happened. In verse 56, the Bible calls it the same way. It says, a destroyer will come upon Babylon. All right? Now, once again, this is not part of the study, but let me just open one paragraph here because I want to introduce to you this idea so you can begin growing in your garden of the brain there, in the back of the brain. So when we come to this study, it'll be easier to assimilate later. When God sent out the kings of the Medes and the Persians against against Jerusalem, against Nebuchadnezzar, God called up, God actually says that he sent the troops of the Medes and the Persians, and those troops, you know what God called it? A swarm of locusts. Because from far, you see like thousands of men and horses, it looks like a swarm of locusts. And throughout the Bible, God uses this language of locusts, you know, a swarm of locusts. Because when there are too many that cannot be numbered by man, when you and I cannot number, it's like a swarm of locusts. So God uses this. Let me share with you the one verse. Look at verse 14. Of Jeremiah 51, verse 14. The Lord Almighty has sworn by himself, I will surely fill you with men. He's talking about the destruction of Nebuchadnezzar. Fill you with men as with a swarm of locusts, and they will shout in triumph over you. So throughout the Bible, we see repeatedly, whenever God sends a nation to conquer, and there's so many numbers that man cannot number, he calls them a swarm of locusts. And the reason why I'm pointing this out to you is because in times of apostasy, who does God send? A destroyer. All right? And when the mercy of God has no more redeeming effect on the people, then what happens? God sends destruction. Now, at the fifth trumpet, when Satan appears and masquerading as Jesus Christ in Revelation 9, verse 10 and 11, guess who that angel is called? That king angel. That king angel is called the Abaddon or Apollyon, which in Greek and in Hebrew means the destroyer. In other words, instead of raising up Nebuchadnezzar in Jerusalem, instead of the kings of the Medes and the Persians to punish Nebuchadnezzar, now he's dealing with the full cup of sin of the whole world, so he allows Satan to be visible. Yes, and then you will understand in a little bit why, a little bit more of it. And that's why a lot of people don't understand that analogous language there, but once you have the basic four rules of apocalyptic interpretation, everything can be very clearly and easily sorted out. But we're going to get to that some other time. But I just want you to get that in the, you know, to start thinking about that, because this happens repeatedly throughout the Old Testament. Now that I said it, when you're reading, you're going to see it too. Now, let's get back here. We're not too far, so hang with me, okay? Because I know this is a lot. And stop me anytime, ask questions. Please don't feel that we're recording that we cannot stop and answer questions. No problem at all.
Well, where are we now?
Now, we are in Jeremiah 51, but we're actually headed to Ezekiel 4, 5, and 6. I'm going to show you something very fascinating. The book of Ezekiel, chapter 4, verse 5 and 6. All right, Ezekiel 4, 5 and 6. This is a very familiar verses to us. Look at verse 5. When you're there, let me hear you say amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right. I meant to get this printed because I had this printed, but I lost my USB stick, so forgive me. I have assigned you the same number of days as the number of years of their sin. For 390 days, you will bear the sin of the house of Israel. How many days? 390. Please remember that. Then, verse 6, after you have finished this, lie down again, this time on your right side, and bear the sin of the house of Judah. I have assigned you 40 days, you know, to Judah. a day for each year. Now, if you have a calculator, in a little bit we're going to need a calculator. I'm going to need a volunteer. But so 430 years, 390 plus 40 was, you know, days here, each day, God says 1 year, was the number of year of their guilt, was the number of year of the sin of Israel. In other words, for 430 years, Israel did not rest, you know, the seventh year that they were supposed to rest, that let the land rest, the seventh year. During those 400 years, they did not allow, they were supposed to rest every 50 year. They did not do it. All right? Now, so for 430 years, they were disobedient. Now I'm going to show you something very interesting, very fascinating. Go to 2 Chronicles 36, 21. 2 Chronicles 36, 21. All right. When you're there, let me hear, say amen.
36,
correct, yes. Yes, 2 Chronicles 36, starting at verse 21. Actually, only the verse 21.
Amen.
All right. The Bible says, the land enjoyed its Sabbath rest. Rests. It's a past tense. It had already happened. All the time of its desolation, it rested. In other words, it became desolated, destroyed for the whole time, until the 70 year were completed in fulfillment of the word of the Lord, the word of the Lord spoken by Jeremiah. So God is saying that yes, at the end of the 70 years that Jews went into captivity with Nebuchadnezzar, that's the year that Daniel was thrown into the lion's den, and then he came out of the lion's den alive, and he found favor with the king. The king allowed and signed a decree for all Israel to be able to go back once again to where they came from, and that's exactly to the T. It was actually the 70th year. Just God predicted. Now the question is this, why? Now, do you have your calculator, Sister Pam? Now, remember, they were supposed to rest 1 year, let the land rest 1 year out of every seventh. So you divide 430 years, which was the total number of years that they lived in the land, divided by seven. What is it?
61.40.
All right, so now put 61.4 and write that down, 61.4. All right, now if you do 61.4, now do another math for me, 430 divided by 50, because they were supposed to rest let the land rest one year every 50. So go ahead and do the math, please.
8.6.
So 61.4 plus 8.6 Sabbath that they should have rested. Added that up, please, and see what the total is. 70 years of rest they should have given to the land, and they did not allow the land rest for 70 years. And remember what God says, if you don't allow it to rest, I'm going to yank you out, and it's still going to rest one way or another.
So, give me the math again.
Well, there was 430 years. That's the total number of years that they lived in the land until their cup was full, their cup of sin was full, divided by seven, because they were supposed to rest 1 year out of every seven, and 430 divided by 50th. Sister Lily, we're going to work on that, okay?
Okay.
Don't worry, we'll stay over and cover it. I'll go over with you again. Yeah, so 430 divided by 50. Right. That is exactly, because God had promised them that he would punish them according to the number of years of their sin. Not one day year less, not one more. Now, the reason why I'm taking the time to show you this is because God is an exact God. He's a precise God, I should have said. Everything he says, he means it. And everything he means it, he says it too. So if something is in the Bible, And we just the fact that we don't understand, it does not mean that God doesn't mean what he says, All right? So now with this in mind, I'm going to remember what God said to Israel. If you are disobedient to me, I'm going to send you famine, sword, plague, and wild beasts. Remember that? Now, I'm going to show you how this repeats throughout the whole Bible. I'm not going to show you all the passages, thank God. But I'm going to show you maybe two or three more passages. Then I'm going to make a point. Okay? Go to Deuteronomy 32, please. Deuteronomy 32. Remember rule number three. Says that interpretation could be literal, symbolic, and analogous, or analogous. If it's symbolical, God defines a symbol. If it's analogous, you know, we need to use a Bible parallels and let the Bible explain itself. So we're doing that right now, even though I haven't told you, but that's exactly what we're doing. So yeah, that's why we're doing a little bit of history here. Now look with me. Deuteronomy 32 is starting at verse 16, but let me first say what's going on here, the context. When God had the children, he delivered the children of Israel out of the bondage of sin in Egypt, out of Pharaoh's hand, he delivered them. The moment they crossed the sea, God parted and they passed through victoriously, and then God closed and smited the Egyptians. Well, God gave them a song. All right, and they were praising God and singing the song. It's called the Song of Moses. And very interesting, in this song, embedded in the words of these songs, there's a prophecy that the Israelites had no idea at that time, but they would soon to find out in the wrong way. I mean, the hard way, although God tried to warn them, but they wouldn't listen. So now look with me in verse Deuteronomy 32, starting at verse 16. The Bible says, they made him jealous. It's talking about the rock, Savior. They made him jealous with their foreign gods and angered him with their detestable idols. They sacrificed to demons which are not God, gods they had not known. Gods that recently appeared, gods your forefathers did not fear. You, verse 18, you deserted the rock who fathered you. You forgot the God who gave you birth. The Lord, this is all part of the song. The Lord saw this and rejected them because he was angered by his sons and daughters. And then verse 20, I will hide my face from them, he said, and see what their end will be. They are a perverse generation, children of the unfaithful. All right, who are unfaithful. Now look at verse 24 with me. Verse 24, I will send wasting famine against them. Underline that word famine. Consuming pestilence and deadly plague. Underline those words. I will send against them the fangs of wild beasts, underline wild beasts, the venom of the viper that glide in the dust. Verse 25, in the street the sword will make them childless. In their home terror will reign. Young men and young women will perish, infants and so forth. But the point here is that God will send those four things. And on, he repeats these things throughout the Bible. Let me show you another one. Go to Jeremiah 34. I'm going to show you this one and another one. And then we'll arrive at our destination. Jeremiah 34. I'm looking at verses 17 and verse 20. Just to save some time, we could read through the whole thing, but I'll just go to 17 and 20, and you can study this at home with more time. So verse 17 of Jeremiah 34, the Bible says, therefore this is what the Lord God said, the Lord says, you have not obeyed me, You have not proclaimed freedom to your fellow countrymen, so I now proclaim freedom for you, declares the Lord, freedom to fall by the sword, plague, and famine. Okay, I will make you abhorrent to all the kingdom of the earth. And look at verse 20. I will hand over to their enemies who seek their lives. Their dead bodies will become food for the birds of the air and the beasts of the earth. All right. Now, like I said, there are several others, but I'm just going to show you one, which is my favorite one, because God explains to us why he does what he does. So God is not a God that does... Sometimes he does strange things because we think it's very strange, but then he actually tells us why he does it. But sometimes we don't hear it. And that's why we have all the doubts. That's why we don't understand the God of the new, the God of the old. And we have created this icon, this idol called, well, not everyone. You know, obviously there's God has his faithful people. I'm not pointing fingers at no one, but a lot of people have created an idol called Jesus. Notice, go to Ezekiel 14, and we're going to park here for a little bit, and then we arrive at our destination. While you're finding it, I heard a very, very interesting thing the other day, that a scholar have actually found proof, archaeological proof, that they can prove beyond a shadow of doubt that in the days of Adam and Eve, in the days of the antediluvians, the time of the flood, that they were actually legalizing same-sex marriage by law. The time of Sodom and Gomorrah and the time of the flood, they were actually legalizing it. The state had accepted it. And very interesting that right now, and then you know what the end was, you know that right now they're pushing that very hard at nationwide, not just state. And I believe that, wow, that's like, wow, that's a full cup. That's a... Can you imagine, you know, the implication of what we're talking about here? Now, go to Ezekiel 14. What I appreciate about Ezekiel 14, verse 5, and I'm using the NIV version. I'm not against any other Bible versions. I think they're all great. I think that a student should have a choice of what they want to study. But I think it's wise to have more than one Bible and not just one, so you could compare. Sometimes one, it's a little obscure. It's difficult to understand some of the older versions. Then you can kind of compare notes and get the best out of it. When you look at the NIV in verse 5, God is actually telling us why he's going to do these strange things. Notice, God is saying, I will do this to recapture the hearts of the people of Israel who have all deserted me for their idols. Wow. So in other words, whatever I'm about to do here is to recapture the hearts of the people who have forgotten me. In other words, my desire, God's desire was to have a very intimate relationship with Israel. But they were stubborn. So they went after other gods, gods that weren't really gods at all. And they deserted the true God who fathered them, who created them. So God is saying, look, what I'm going to do here is to actually bring you back to me once again. It's to recapture your heart when you lose the heart of a son or a daughter, but then you recapture their hearts back and bring them back to you. So this is an act of love. Just like when you spank a child, you don't spank them because you hate them. You spank them because you want to save them. You want to recapture their heart and teach them principles. All right? So notice, let's now go to verse 13, Ezekiel 14, verse 13. God is saying here to Ezekiel, God says, son of man, if a country sins. Now notice here that we're not just dealing with Israel anymore, right? Now it's just more than Israel. Now if a country, general, sins against me by being unfaithful, and I stretch out my hand against it to cut off its food supplies and send what? famine upon it and kill its men and their animals, even if these three men, the most righteous men of the Bible, Noah, this is my own words, Noah, Daniel, and Job, if they were in it, they could save only themselves by the righteousness, declares the sovereign Lord. Or if I send wild beasts, underline that, through that country, and they leave it childless and becomes desolate so that no one could pass through it because of the beasts, as surely as I live, declares the sovereign Lord, even if these three men were in it, they could not save their own sons or daughters. They alone would be saved, but the land would be desolate. Or, verse 17, if I bring a sword, underline that word, against it, against that country, and say, let the sword pass throughout the land and kill its men and their animals, as surely as I live, declares the sovereign Lord, even if these three men were in it, they could not save their own sons or daughters. They alone would be saved. Or if I send a plague into that land and pour out my wrath upon it through bloodshed, killing its men and their animals, as surely as I live, declares the sovereign Lord, even if Noah, Daniel, and Job were in it, they could not save neither sons nor daughter. They would save only themselves by their righteousness. Now let me point out here. Is there really a need for God to repeat this on and on and on again, the same things? Well, the reason why God does, when he keeps on repeating something, it emphasizes the importance, the emphasis that he's putting it. He wants to make sure that we get it. This is huge, all right? This is huge. So even if these three righteous men, they could only save themselves, but not their sons or daughter. I'm not, you know, salvation is individual. Now notice the amazing, how amazing verse 21 is. For this is what the sovereign Lord says, how much worse will it be when I send against Jerusalem my four dreadful judgments, sword and famine and wild beasts and plague, to kill its men and their animals. So what does God call these four plagues? What does he call it? He is four dreadful judgments. Is dreadful something nice?
No.
Now God is going to tell us why he does it. He already did in verse 5, but he's going to clarify it even more. Notice. Notice verse 22. In other words, when I send these things, these four deadly, dreadful judgments, there will be some survivors. Now let me stop here for a second. If an earthquake happens in a city, and there's 100 people in that city, and there's casualty, the people that survive are called the survivors. But in order for it to be survivors, there has to be casualties, right? So God is saying here, once I send these four dreadful judgments, there will be a lot of casualties. That's what he's telling us. Yet, there will be survivors, sons and daughters, who will be brought out of it alive. And now notice, they will come to you, he's speaking to Ezekiel, in other words, they will come to the man of God, they will come to leaders, to church pastors, they will come to the people that are supposed to be close to God. And notice what he says, and when you see their conduct and their actions, you will be consoled. Now another word for consoled is comforted. Regarding the disaster that I have brought upon Jerusalem, every disaster that I have brought upon it, you will be consoled when you see their conduct and their actions, for you will know that I have done nothing in it without a cause, declares the sovereign Lord. Wow. This is amazing. What God is saying here is this. Let's just say Israel is 100 people. The whole children of Israel, they're just 100 people. And they're going into a path that they're going into destruction. And 100 of them are about to commit a suicide, in a way, with their conduct. They're going in a path of destruction, corporately. They're all going to die because they're so evil. They have gone so bad. Now God is saying, I will bring these four dreadful judgments to recapture the hearts of my people back to me. And yes, it's true, a lot of them will die. Let's just say 25 of the 100 will die. But 75 will be saved and their lives will change. There will be a conversion experience. The lives, you're going to be able to look at their lives, and by their actions, you're going to notice the change. In other words, their hearts will be recaptured back to God. So in other words, I love you so much, but I need to amputate a foot in order to save the whole body. You see what I'm saying? Sometimes, I mean, God, we have no idea how it is to be God. It is a very difficult task to be God. A lot of times we don't understand and we think it's easy. But it's not easy because you love your foot, you love your child, but if I don't intervene, all of you are going into destruction and 100 of you will perish. So I'm going to allow 25, and in fact, I'm going to be the one bringing this destruction, and 25 or 30 of them are going to perish, but 70 or 65 will turn back to me. You see, corporately speaking, God has to intervene and make some very tough choices sometimes. So this is fascinating to see the love of God, even in, I mean, you're going to hear a lot of people talking about the love of God, the grace of God, the mercy of God, but what preachers are not telling you is the justice of God. They are not telling you, because nobody wants to hear about the truth. Nobody wants to hear about these things. Hardly anybody, I shouldn't say nobody, but hardly anyone, hardly very few people are willing to hear the truth about these things. But when you actually understand it, it's not as bad as we think, because we see that God is doing this, even though it's some very difficult things to swallow, the whole reason behind it is love. Now, with this in mind, I want to show you, turn your Bibles to Galatians, please. Galatians 3. Wait a second, let me get that. Galatians 3. Galatians is right between Genesis and Revelation. I'm having a hard time finding it. Here it is. All right. So Galatians 3, starting at verse 5, the Apostle Paul is saying something very interesting here. He says, wait a second. Remember first in Leviticus 26, that God calls these four judgments, a sudden terror will fall upon you. Remember that? Mm-hmm. All right, keep that in mind. Remember when they say peace and safety, what's going to fall upon you? Sudden destruction. Same principle at work. Now, notice what Paul says, beginning at verse 5. Colossians chapter 3, verse 5. Colossians. Did I say Galatians? I'm sorry. It's Colossians. No. Yes, Colossians. Well, I just didn't want you to read ahead of me, so. Just kidding. All right, when you're there, I'm here, say amen. All right, verse 5 says, put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, sexual immorality. Do we have any problems of that in our society today? Impurity, lust, any of that today? Evil desires and greed. Anyone greedy? Which is idolatry. Because of what? These things, the wrath of God is coming upon the world. So in other words, it is because of these very things that the wrath of God is coming. Now, when you have underlined and wrote your notes, turn your Bibles with me to Revelation. Mm-hmm. Revelation 6. Revelation 6, verse 7 and 8. And when you hear, let me hear, say amen. You there? All right. Verse 7. When the Lamb opened the fourth seal, remember that's what we're studying today. When the Lamb opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of a fourth living creature say, "Come." And I looked, and there before me was a pale horse. Its rider name was Death, and Hades was following close behind him. Hades is the grave, was following close behind him. They, it doesn't say who they were, but I'm going to soon tell you, they were given power over one-fourth of the earth to kill by the sword, famine, plague, and by the wild beasts of the earth. In other words, what is going to bring the time of trouble? You know, what is going to bring the beginning? God is going to break the fourth seal, and 25% of the population will perish. This is necessary to recapture the hearts of the people back to God. When corporately speaking, the earth, when God feels that the earth has reached the full cup, their cup is full, then God intervenes by bringing his four dreadful judgments. Now, we're not going to get into it in details today, but I'll tell you how this is going to happen. God, when we read in, it says, look at verse 8 again. I looked, and there before me was a pale horse. Its rider name was Death, and Hades was following behind, and they were given power. Where did you read anywhere today in the beginning of the Bible studies that they also were given power to harm the land and the earth and the sea? The four angels. The four angels at that point will blow. And then Revelation 7, verses 1 through 4, you have the four angels. Now, where do you suppose you should go to find out what the devastation of the four angels are? You go to Revelation 8, which is the next chapter, which in reality is not a chapter at all, because God never gave division, separation. Those were just added there for reference purpose, for us to find the verses. Revelation 8, the Bible says that there will be a meteor shower. The earth will be hit by a meteor shower that will burn one-third of the earth, killing millions of people. Then followed by an asteroid impact on a sea and tidal waves that will be hundreds of feet high will wash all the coastal cities and killing millions. Then what else? The third trumpet will sound, and there is an asteroid impact on a continent, causing bitterness and poison that will come out from outer space into the atmosphere and poison, and many people will die out of that poisonous water. And it is all scientifically proven that when something like that happens, what it does, it actually ignites volcanoes because of the pressure of the impact on the earth. This is what happens. And the fourth trumpet, the Bible says that one-third of the day and one-third of the night will be darkened. In other words, volcanic ashes is the only thing that covers the day and night. Those are the volcanic ashes. I mean, this, what I'm sharing with you, is so systematically, it's so in harmony with the laws of nature that it's not even a joke. And beyond, for reasons that is beyond the scope of this Bible study, that all that will happen within 64 days. Okay? From the time the fourth seal breaks, the 25% of the earth population that if it happened today would be 1.75 billion people, how they would die is by the first four trumpets. In other words, the fourth seal is a shotgun. Those trumpets are the bullets that come out of the gun. Okay? And that's within 64 days. And that is the catalyst. That is the catalyst that begins the tribulation. From the time of the first all the way into the fourth.
Okay.
Uh-huh. And like I said, it's beyond the scope of the study today, but it's about 64 days. And so now imagine what this will do, and I'm not going to talk here for another, for how long? What time do we have right now?
Eight.
All right, just in time. Let me just say this. We know that there is a time of trouble comes, but no one understands the reason what will bring this time of trouble. Because we have a lot of religions have traditionally applied this in the past for a reason or another that we're not going to get into it today also, which I have emailed you a detailed explanation already. So we have not been diligent in studying these things, and we have not let the Bible interpret itself. So anything that we don't understand, it's symbolic. Oh, it must have been this, it must have been that, is that. But when you allow the Word of God to explain itself and why God does, how beautiful it is, Lord, it gives me goosebumps. Because the world will know the authority of Christ when the fourth seal breaks. And this is what is going to break the walls of religion and denomination that will get the whole world and will get men that are too busy and too greedy to actually stop working and pay attention to what God is saying through His Word. Right now, there's two evil in this world that stop men from learning and from studying God's Word. The first evil is called greed, which is we're too busy working to try to get rich and try to get everything. The second evil may offend you, but it's called religion. Because your religion is good for you, mine is good for me. I don't listen to you. Anything that is besides what my religion teaches, I don't care if you're a Buddha, a Muslim, or a Christian, or any kind of denomination, what your church teaches is good for you, what mine teaches is good for me. Less than 1% of the world population ever changes from one religion to another. Less than 5% ever changes from one denomination to another. So there are walls. These walls, God must bring them down. And when these things happen, 50% or more of the earth infrastructure will be brought to an end. In other words, the bank will not open on Monday. Publix will not be available on Monday because the groceries already are gone. And the truck drivers cannot bring because the freeways are done. Because before these things happen, I have not talked about it today, but there's actually a global earthquake also that will be felt globally. If you think the 1755 Lisbon earthquake is anything, wait until you see this one. And it will shake. So the world will be a very difficult place to travel. Where you are, you will remain at that time. Traveling will be very difficult. Computers, electricity will be very scarce. And what happens is that, once again, people will go back to the Word. And this is when... Now, let me just say this for 1 minute, and I promise we'll end. As a result of this, and there's so many options where we can study next week. So many options. Because this gets very fascinating. Because what happens, when something like this happens, men in general, they're going to come together and they say, I know you're a Muslim, I'm a Buddhist, you're a Christian, we don't agree in anything, but in one thing we agree. The man upstairs is angry. So what, you know what we must do? We must appease the wrath of this God up there. And I don't care what religion you are or what you call your God. We must appease His wrath lest we all perish. So then what happens? 10 of the most powerful leaders, this is all part of prophecy that we're not going to talk about today, they will come together with the 7 world religions. And they will name the one religion that has the most influence throughout, that has relations with all people on earth. And you know that's Catholicism. And they're going to give the Pope the power to be the spokesman for this world crisis coalition. And the Pope will have authority to enforce a lot of laws, sinless laws. I'm not talking about the Pope enforcing Catholicism on Muslims, no. I'm talking about the Pope enforcing sinless laws and pass laws such as no gay marriage, no pornography, no drinking, no alcohol, no working on Sundays for Christian nations, no working on Fridays for Muslim nations, no working on Saturdays for Jewish nations. Those will be local laws at first, because all they were trying to do here is appease the wrath of God. But this is a different topic, and I don't want to...
Communication is broken down, so they can't communicate those new laws.
Well, yes, it'll be difficult. It's not going to be as excessive as it is nowadays. But, I mean, there is generators, a lot of generators in place for that kind of stuff. And the United States, they have plans for the grid to fall. So, you know, not all communication will be broken. And but it'll be very, I would say,
limited.
Traveling will be limited. But that's a good point. But we're going to be covering this in future studies. Like I said, the fourth seal leaves us to where you don't want to go into the fifth and sixth and seventh seals. That you just want to like, oh, wait a second. What? This is the catalyst that starts. Now I need to know. Because remember in Revelation 7, and I'm ending, the angels are waiting for the sealing of the 144,000. In other words, the 144,000 will be sealed before all this happen, because they are the ones that are going to proclaim the good news and warn the world of all these things before any of these things begin happening. Okay? So,
before the fourth seal.
Because they're sealed right before to preach. They are the first fruits of God that appear sealed without a carnal nature to preach as mini clones of Jesus Christ when he was on earth to deliver the gospel message. Because remember, the Bible says that God will do nothing unless he revealed to his people through his servants, the prophets. And that's what they're called. In other words, the 144,000 are the first fruits. They are sealed, preach the gospel, and then as a result, a numberless multitudes will come out of all religions, of Muslim, of Hindus, and all under that kind of pressure, the walls will be broken, and it'll create the perfect environment for man to hear the undiluted gospel presented by the 144,000. That's why the Bible says that all 10 virgins go to sleep in Matthew 25. Then there is a shout, prepare, the bridegroom is coming, and they woke up disoriented in the middle of the night. And I say to you, if the 10 virgins represent all churches waiting for the second coming, and I don't know any other churches that disagree, who is it that gives the shout, prepare, the bridegroom is coming? Obviously, a sleeping church cannot awaken herself. Well, God calls his servants, the 144,000, to preach the good news and finish the work that the patriarchs failed, Abraham failed, the Jews failed, the Christian church is failing because of the walls. But the 144,000 under the right environment will finish it. Amen? Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, Lord God, wow. This is amazing, Father. Your word is amazing. Your word is so rich. Your word leaves us speechless, Father. Lord, we thank you so much for the clarity of your word and for interpreting the word for us, that we don't have to be guessing and say, I think this is this, I think this is that, but we can take the word and let your own Bible actually interpret for us. So Lord, I just pray that what we heard here today, that it may be not something that will make people afraid, but Lord, that will reveal to you, to us, your authority, and then how you are a God of love that will not even close mercy and actually put an end into this world without actually giving everyone a fair chance to hear it, Father. So we pray and we thank you so much. Help us to assimilate all these things and to work them in our minds and to actually study these things that we went through here today until they're part of our being, until we really truly understand. So Father, help us to understand your character. Father, help us to accept this revelation of your authority. I pray, Lord, that our hearts and our minds may not be in rebellion against what we heard, but that we may be humble and submit to your word and to what we have heard. Dismiss us now and give us travel mercies and bring us back here once again. It is our prayer in the most wonderful name of Jesus. Amen.